In the last video, I described how glucose 6-phosphate and glucose 1-phosphate are interconverted in an equilibrium reaction. G1P is added to glycogen in an irreversible reaction catalyzed by glycogen synthase, which uses UTP hydrolysis as an energy source. Glucose is removed from glycogen in a separate irreversible reaction catalyzed by glycogen phosphorylase, which is spontaneous under cellular conditions. From these points about the energetics of the reactions, it makes sense that glycogen metabolism is regulated not at the reversible interconversion of G1P and G6P, but by controlling the activities of glycogen synthase and glycogen phosphorylase. Exactly how each enzyme is regulated depends on tissue type. Recall from the last video that skeletal muscle and liver use glycogen for different reasons, and therefore we may want to activate or inhibit these enzymes under different conditions in the different tissues. To allow this differential regulation, we have different versions of these enzymes in our different tissue types. These different versions are called isoforms. For example, skeletal muscle and liver tissue both express a glycogen phosphorylase enzyme that catalyzes removal of glucose from glycogen to make G1P. But these isoforms of glycogen phosphorylase have slightly different amino acid sequences, which allows them to be regulated differently in the different tissues. So with that background, let's see how glycogen synthase and glycogen phosphorylase are regulated in skeletal muscle and liver. In both tissues, the main form of regulation is phosphorylation. When phosphorylated, glycogen synthase becomes less active. In contrast, the phosphorylated form of glycogen phosphorylase is more active than the dephosphorylated form. This is true in both skeletal muscle and in liver. Which form predominates depends on hormone signals. Insulin is a hormone that the pancreas releases into the bloodstream when blood glucose levels are high. In liver and skeletal muscle, insulin in the blood stimulates dephosphorylation of both glycogen synthase and glycogen phosphorylase, thus promoting glycogen synthesis. This makes perfect sense because if the concentration of glucose in the blood is high, that is a perfect time for both tissues to store some of that glucose as glycogen. When blood glucose levels fall, insulin is cleared from the blood and the hormone glucagon predominates. The presence of glucagon in the blood causes phosphorylation of glycogen synthase and glycogen phosphorylase in liver, promoting glycogen breakdown. The liver can then release glucose into the bloodstream to maintain blood glucose levels. However, glucagon does not cause phosphorylation of these enzymes in skeletal muscle because muscle stores glycogen for its own use only. Therefore, it doesn't matter to muscle cells if the blood glucose concentration is low. Muscle will not break down glycogen for that reason. The hormone epinephrine, also called adrenaline, causes phosphorylation of these enzymes in both liver and skeletal muscle. Epinephrine is released under stress conditions, and so the liver breaks down glycogen in anticipation of an increase in the energy need of the body, and skeletal muscle breaks down glycogen in anticipation of increased activity of that muscle. It's important to keep in mind that these hormones do not directly cause phosphorylation or dephosphorylation of the enzymes of glycogen metabolism. The hormones act by binding to receptors on the cell surface. Receptor activation causes a series of events that eventually results in a change in the phosphorylation state of the enzymes. In this course, we're not going to worry about the exact reactions that happen during the signaling cascade, but I wanted you to be aware that these hormones have their effects indirectly through intermediate reactions. In addition to regulation by phosphorylation, glycogen synthase and glycogen phosphorylase are regulated by allosteric effectors. Remember that allosteric effectors can only have their effects when they're at high concentration. Let's look at allosteric regulation in skeletal muscle first. In muscle, glucose 6-phosphate allosterically activates glycogen synthase, indicated by this green dashed arrow. G6P also allosterically inhibits glycogen phosphorylase, indicated by the red dashed line. When G6P concentration is high, there's an excess of glucose monosaccharide in the cell, and it's a great time to store some of that glucose as glycogen. Therefore, the enzyme that makes glycogen is activated, and the enzyme that degrades glycogen is inhibited. Also, ATP is an allosteric inhibitor of glycogen phosphorylase in muscle. A high concentration of ATP in the muscle cell means that that cell has a lot of available energy, so there's no need for the cell to break down glycogen. But if ATP is being used up, then its concentration will fall, and the concentration of ADP and AMP in the cell will increase. It turns out that AMP is an allosteric activator of glycogen phosphorylase in muscle. When AMP concentrations are high, the muscle cell needs energy, and it will release glucose from storage by breaking down glycogen. As in muscle cells, the liver isoform of glycogen synthase is allosterically activated by G6P. Glycogen phosphorylase in liver is inhibited by glucose. This makes sense because if there's a lot of glucose around, then the liver should synthesize glycogen, not break it down. But unlike in muscle cells, the liver enzymes are not allosterically regulated by ATP or AMP. This is because ATP and AMP are indicators of the energy status of the liver cell, and the liver does not break down glycogen for its own use. Therefore, a liver cell will not break down glycogen because of high AMP levels in that cell. The liver will restore its own energy levels in other ways, as we'll see in later topics. In this video, I went through many details about regulation of glycogen metabolism. It's important for students in the course to note that we will not expect you to memorize specific allosteric effectors of enzymes or whether the phosphorylated or unphosphorylated forms of an enzyme are active. For tests, you should focus on understanding the biochemical logic of why an enzyme or pathway is activated or inhibited. For example, we do expect you to know that glycogen synthase is favored when the concentration of insulin, and therefore glucose, is high in the blood. But you won't be asked to remember that insulin causes dephosphorylation of glycogen synthase. In the next video, we'll look at glycolysis and fermentation.